So, hey everybody, I am so excited to be with you today. We've got quite a short agenda for you today, which Gillian's going to tell us just a little bit about.
So we're going to look at a case study of running a design sprint at Mulegy. That's a supply chain software company that I work at here in Toronto. And then Kim is going to take us through
a design sprint simulation. It's going to be really short, about 15 minutes, but we're hoping that you get a feel for what a design sprint or the different activities that is in a design sprint is like. And then finally, we're going to give you some summary and takeaways that you can do to run your next design sprint. I'm just curious to know, how many of you have actually ran a design sprint?
Because I certainly had not run one before I met Kim.
All right. Well, Kaylee, thank you. And Sheila has also run a design sprint. So that's great to hear. We have some people who are experienced, some people who are curious, like I was when I first started running it. But let us tell you the time that Gillian and I ran a design sprint, and we learned a lot more than we expected. And I'm really, really happy that you can all be with us as we go through this journey together. And I'm even more excited to be partnered up with Gillian here. She is an extraordinary person that I got to know over the last few months. Before she called me up, I had no idea who she was, but I got to know her and how generous she was with her time to help her team and our colleagues reach their goals, including mine, actually. So what I learned about Gillian is that she's this trained Agilist, but even more awesome, she kayaks every moment that she gets. As soon as Lake Ontario is no longer frozen, she goes out there and kayaks. And then on top of all that, she also did this amazing thing and launched a book for professional coaching for Agilists. Why don't you show us this book so we know what to look for when we're browsing on our bookstore? Congratulations, Gillian.
Thanks.
Yeah, so we had this amazing opportunity to work together, and I was excited when she called me up.
Yes, and I called up Kim, who works at AdaptiveX. Kim is a consultant, and AdaptiveX provides design sprint facilitation and training as well in things like product owner workshops. Now, I hadn't worked with Kim before, and when she joined, I just felt immediately comfortable because of her big smile. And as you're gonna see with the slides that she drafted, the color and the characters are really uplifting, and been really, really had a great time working with her. It might help us to show folks how to spotlight us so they can see both of us as we present.
Yeah, absolutely. So just for everyone who's joining, if you're curious as to who this Kim and Gillian is that's speaking to you right now, you can go to the top corner, at the right top corner of your Zoom window and click on the speaker view. And I saw that someone just asked what the name of your book is, Gillian. So if you can just show it to us one more time, and then we'll get right on it. Perfect. Professional Coaching for Agilists by Gillian Lee and Damon Poole. So make sure you get that. So there we were. Gillian had invited me to run this design sprint with her. And I said yes immediately, and she got to work putting together a design sprint team, a Mulegy design sprint team. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that experience, Gillian?
Sure. So it was the start of 2021, and our head of product, he's a little bit like a Steve Jobs. He wears a black turtleneck, jeans, glasses, and he said to me, Gillian, we really need to nail our strategy for this year. And, you know, we failed twice before. This time we've got to get it right. And so I called up Kim and I said, I needed a design sprint yesterday. Can you come and help us run one next week?
And I said, yes, absolutely.
So,
it was the perfect recipe for a design sprint. It was this hugely complex problem. They've spent millions on it, but they haven't gotten any resolution. But in order to run a design sprint, we needed a design sprint team.
Right. So I learned from Kim that we need a wide variety of people across a variety of disciplines, sales, product, also customer success, engineering, and designers. And I think the toughest part of it was asking everyone to clear their schedules. Yeah. So John, one of our engineers, said to me, John likes to delegate things to other people. But after speaking with Kim and myself, he realized that I don't want to mortgage my future. I'll participate.
It was perfect. So Gillian put together this amazing, fantastic 9 of her colleagues to clear their schedule and join us for a full week of discovery. And I was really excited to kick things off on Monday. And on Monday morning, we've all had barely enough caffeine in our system, but we were all ready to get down to it. And I just remember this one team member who had a really towering presence and really made it known. And I remember as I was explaining what we're going to do on Monday morning, he just comes up to the camera, unmutes himself and says, "Well, Kim, this isn't my first rodeo, so why don't we just get down to it?" And I was a little bit intimidated, but it wasn't the first time that I had a character like this on a design sprint team. And we'll give him the name George. So George was there along with his other colleagues, and we were all there for Monday morning. And as you can see in this little diagram that we have, Monday is all about making a map and choosing a target. But what you don't see here is it's also about understanding the challenge. And so this is really what I asked of the team, to keep an open mind so that we can look at the problem that Bob was talking about in a new light. And what we did there was Gillian, aside from putting together this amazing team, also put together a series of interviews with industry experts.
So we have people from we had customers from different industries come in and talk to us about the issues that they were facing with producing consumer packaged goods. So just to give you a bit of context, our customers are people who make things like paper towel and toilet paper and all that good stuff that we've been hoarding this year.
And what I learned during this whole exploration day was all these people that were manufacturing things that we really needed over the last year with toilet paper and toothpaste were just writing down their forecasts and what they need for materials on like a post-it. And sometimes it was even as like basic as a Tim Hortons napkin. That's how basic it was. It was crazy. And I finally understood the problem, and so did other people. And so I remember Gillian telling me this anecdote from Bob.
So Bob says, after the first day, "I've been working on this problem now for 2 years. And I finally feel like everyone can see what's been going on in my brain and can help me figure this out."
Yeah. So not only could they see it, but they can actually tangibly see it, because the day ended with a map, and it also ended with a target user that we can use for the next day.
Yeah. So we started the next day with a challenge. And the challenge was to help people who plan production of these consumer packaged goods to forecast what they are able to produce to meet the needs of their customers.
Exactly. So to put it even more simply, what the challenge was, how might we help these manufacturers ensure that we don't run out of toilet paper again in case another pandemic hits? Hope to God it doesn't. But so on Tuesday, what we were doing was we're ideating on solutions for the challenge that would help the end user, the co-manufacturing planners. And so they were really, the team was really ready to get down to it and start tossing around solution. And of course, we had George, who was ready to pitch his solution. And I obviously, again, had to rain on his parade because I told them to hold on one second. We're not quite ready to solution yet. Because Gillian, as you know, in a design sprint, I like to remind our team that everyone doesn't have to be a creative genius and they don't have to start from anything from the scratch. So what we do on Tuesday morning is we actually send them out to the web, to surf the web and look for inspiration.
Right, so if you remember, we started Tuesday with a challenge, but no solution. And yes. Kim encourages everyone to find inspiration from other applications. And then the next thing we did was we put pen to paper and started sketching.
Yes, so everyone was buzzing with all these different inspiration from the lightning demo. Everyone was sort of really ready to get down to it. And we took them to a sketching exercise so that they can further refine the challenge their solution, their proposed solution. And what happens is they work together alone and everyone was in their own little corners. Everyone still had their webcams turned on, but they were using pen and paper to sketch this out. So with that, I just remember ending the day finally from, you know, hundreds of different ideas. And then we finally ended up with 8 very concrete solutions to the problem. And I remember Bob saying, oh my God, it was so nice to get back to my roots and just focus on solving one problem. And this is Bob, the VP, who has 16 meetings a day. And he was just really excited to come up to see what everyone came up with.
Right, so we had one idea from each person who came from that different discipline, pulling from the inspirations that they found earlier in the day from different applications on the web. So we ended the day, we had some ideas, but then we had to pick one.
Yes, and that's where we left off Tuesday. And so Wednesday morning, we're all buzzed to see this like 9 different solutions, but we were so unaware of the impending doom that was about to come. So before everyone saw the solution, and just so for your context, Wednesday morning actually starts with a thing called an art museum. And what happens as a facilitator, I reveal each of the sketch and each of these sketch remain anonymous. We don't know who the artist is behind the solution. And what I do is I try my best to walk the group through each solution, point out the features that I think would be interesting or solves for the problem. And then I read out key elements to the group. So up to this point, Gillian, I don't know if you remember, but everyone was having fun. Even George was mildly interested in what others have come up with. And like, to be honest, everyone came up with such brilliant solutions.
They did. Are we going to show some of the storyboards or?
No, we're not. The storyboard comes after the deciding.
Okay. So with these 8 sketches, we had to pick one option. And as you can imagine, everyone's feeling really great until you have to let go of something. So on the one hand, we had Bob, remember, black turtleneck, glasses, jeans. And he's thinking, how far can we push it? And then on the other side, you have John, who's like super agilist. How thin can I slice things? And John is slacking me saying, I wonder if this MVP is multiple years of work. I wonder if we're gonna spend another 2 years building something that will never go to market.
Yeah, so, you know, that tension between Charlie and John, that exists in this moment where you really have to make a decision and place a bet on one thing, but this is the point of a design sprint. The point of a design sprint is to say, we have many, many options, but we want to focus on one and test it with the user. And this is sort of what we had to remind the group. And it also helped that Bob explained his rationale on picking such a complex sketch. What he told us, me as a facilitator, is he wants to see what features in this complex solution would resonate most with the users so that the team can zero in on those features and test them again for the next iteration sprint. So we moved on and started with the storyboard.
So picture this. In a regular design thinking session, you'd have like a whiteboard, you'd walk up to it, I'd lean over Kim's shoulder, draw something, put a sticky there. And instead, we're all like this on a Zoom call from our living rooms or wherever.
Yeah.
Sketching on digital whiteboard with Slack.
Yeah, I definitely was hoping that the storyboard exercise would help sort out the knots and the friction, because like finally there was an opportunity for the team to collaborate on one thing and talk it through and have like a semi-structured conversation. Together they were supposed to build this, you can see it on the screen here, like detailed panels that will take the designers and developers to a step-by-step guide on how to develop a prototype and what it should be doing and what it may look like for the users. So there was this free-flowing conversation, and it was very different from the other parts of the design sprint where they got to work together alone. But as Gillian said earlier, we were all working on a digital whiteboard. We were on Zoom, so there was like this barrier. We can only speak one at a time. And everyone was talking in very abstract terms and basically choosing this as an opportunity to veer the solution towards what they think it should be, rather than what it is.
So at this point, I can feel just a bit of tension building in my neck, because I have pulled together 9 people, 2 VPs, 3 directors, an engineering manager, all these people for 5 days. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, at the end of 5 days, we're going to have nothing to show.
And that was understandable, 100%. And so I had to sort of look at it again and see how we might be able to structure the storyboard. And we tried and we tried. And at this point, we were just running out of time. And John had just said, this is insanity. How can we possibly prototype this tomorrow if we have no cohesive storyboard? So he suggested that we stay or meet late night that night to finish the storyboarding.
And so at this point, my heart sank because I had told everyone that we wouldn't be needing to work overtime, that it would be only sort of like during the regular working hours. So while it was wonderful that we had decided on a solution to move forward with, there were still a lot of unanswered questions. And the very next day on Thursday, we had to go and build the prototype.
Yep. And so the next day when we were about to build the prototype, we were surprised because we came from having this type of a storyboard and we woke up and the storyboard became like this, even less comprehensive and even less concrete for the developers. And so, surprise, surprise, we started Thursday, prototype day, the only time we actually get to build something, discussing the storyboard again. We had George bringing our attention back to the storyboard and what we should probably add on to it. But I remember John having none of it because...
John, sort of like banging his fist on the table because he's just not that kind of guy. He said, listen, every minute we spend discussing the storyboard, we can't prototype.
And he was right. It was true. So I think he suggested, let's send the designers to the breakout room so they can focus. Because also at this point, only the designers know how to use the tool that we were using to prototype. And so since they were the only ones who knew how to use the prototyping tool, we all agreed that they can work on their own in a breakout room while we sort out the missing elements from the storyboard.
So just shortly before lunch, the designers come back to check in with the rest of the group, and they're presenting what they've put together so far, which is like this beautiful click-through prototype. And George, you know, this isn't, you know, George, this isn't my first rodeo guy, says, what makes it so hard to like sketch this graph? Here's like 15 slides with 35 examples.
Yeah. And as you can probably imagine, that created even more tension for the designers, because we had someone who had no idea how to use the tool telling them how hard could it be. And I'm sure for any of you who have developed something, this is something that you resonate with. And so John was tuned in and he can feel the tension. So he just steps in again and volunteered to be the liaison between the designer and the executive so that the designers can focus on just building a clickable prototype. And then at this point, I remember Gillian just breathing a sigh of relief because John does this in his everyday job.
Yeah. So we did have the afternoon for them to keep working, and they did come back just before the end of the day so that we could work together on preparing for the user test that we would do on Friday. So yeah. For the user test on Friday, the rest of the team have been preparing a script to interview the users based around the prototype we were building. So we did a quick run through, but at the end of it, the team said to me, we still have 2 hours of work to do. So we really need to stop talking and get back to work.
Yeah, so the designers were again in a tight spot and they had to pull another late night. It wasn't ideal, but we're really proud of them and we're really thankful to them because they did pull it off and they had a clickable prototype ready for the next day, which is the most exciting part of the design sprint.
And yeah. And this part is around testing and validating your idea with actual customers. And this was like the whole point of it, which is we wanted to make sure the customers would want to buy our solution before we went and built it. And so we were so excited to talk with 5 customers who, I don't know how many emails, phone calls, Starbucks gift cards I had to send out to make this happen, but they did come in and meet with us to click through the prototype and give us their feedback on what they would like to see.
Yeah, so we were prepared and we had the script ready to learn more about their motivations, what they liked, what they didn't like about the solution. I was, as a facilitator, I was just expecting to run it as I would all my other user interviews. You know, everyone on the team will be listening in. They had their cameras off. They'd be taking notes and maybe reserving some questions until the end, and that I'd only be interviewing one user at a time for 45 minutes. But boy, was I wrong. First of all, there wasn't just one user that I interview per hour. I interviewed 2, sometimes 3 of them. So I had to get through this entire script, wait for their feedback within 45 minutes. And then on top of that, the team also requested that we have a Slack message, like a Slack messaging channel.
So while Kim is very graciously interviewing our user, our customers, trying to get through this script, mind you, it was like 5 pages long script for 45 minutes and 3 customers. We had the entire sprint team Slack messaging her questions of things that they would like to ask while she was interviewing them. And I've just felt really bad for Kim because I didn't know how she would possibly be able to stay focused on our customers and also respond to everyone's questions.
And so, she had every right to be worried about me because I really wasn't able to balance all of it all at once. And at some point, I just saw an angry message saying, Kim, why aren't you asking my questions? And in my head, I was just like, I have 100 other questions to get through, but we'll get to it.
So we did get to some of the key questions. And after each customer interview, we debriefed and we had a little bit of an improvement. For example, we had people put little comments on, hey, this Slack message is a comment, not a question. And that helped Kim know what she really needed to pay attention to.
Yes, exactly. So at the end of the day, we worked it out and it was challenging at first, but we got through it and completed the user test.
Yay!
And so we, I sighed a breath of relief.
and so did I, because we had validated that, yes, the people who are planning production of all these packaged goods did really want to see forecasts, did really want to see some scenario planning. And in fact, they would want to use this tool 4 out of 5 if it was available to them. So what a relief. We knew that if we went forward with investing an engineering team in this, that it would have a higher likelihood of being picked up by our customers. And
so that was a really great result for that first design sprint. And when we concluded that, not only did we learn that this product was going to sell to the end users that they were targeting, but as a facilitator and for Gillian also, we learned other things.
Right. So we learned that with respect to running a design sprint, I had heard that it was a roller coaster. I really had no idea just how high and how low it would go. One thing that we really missed is, you know, that coffee machine, that water cooler in the office where we can sort of gather together and just you know, chat, relax, connect. As facilitators, hear how people are doing. And that became really apparent when you have such a wide variety of people from many levels, like VPs, individual contributors working together as pretty much sort of equal contributors on a focused activity together. Whereas like typically they're just having like transactional interactions. The other thing that we learned was that for, storyboarding. Well, you remember what it was like, Kim?
It was chaotic.
Right? So we learned that it would be really helpful to add a little bit more structure. For that, we pulled some techniques that we use in just, you know, facilitation of other events to help us time box it, check that people were bought in, and if not, find out what it was so that we could gain more consensus before moving on.
Yes.
And go ahead, Kim.
Those were the things that we learned. And then the other thing was for the user test, I learned that before I say yes to having a Slack channel, I should probably establish some norms and just remind everybody that what we're trying to get out of the user test is not really walking them through and selling them the solution, but really getting their honest feedback from an established interview script that we had previously agreed upon. So those are just little reminders that I had to make for myself as a facilitator.
One other thing we did too was we set the context a little more strongly in the second design sprint that we had a week later. So we were fortunate enough to be able to bring in Kim to do 2 sprints for us. While the second roller coaster was exciting, it was not the scariest one I've been on. And we knew that things went better because when we did a retrospective at the end of the second design sprint, people mentioned how much more focused we were how much they felt like we had collaborated better and that everyone on the team was more, felt more respected. So it wasn't perfect, right? There's still sort of those existing tensions of different people having different views of what they'd like to achieve. But overall, we sort of validated some of the things that we thought might help. And we'd like to share those with you. Yeah.
Yeah. So we've just talked you guys through this entire story of what our design sprint felt like, the first one at least. And then the second one went a little bit better. And now we just really want to turn to you, hopefully, because we believe that practice trumps theory. And so in just a moment here, we're going to be taking you to a mural board where we're going to run through a couple of design sprint activities, like I promised. So that paper and that pen will come in handy soon. But before that, I want to introduce you to Zip, a video conferencing platform. And now Zip's head of product has recruited us as a sprint team to solve a challenge for them. And the challenge was she wants to try and expand Zip's services to accommodate large-scale virtual event platforms. So to put it simply, it's basically how might we create a new offering that will appeal to large event organizations like Rebecca and Sheila, who organized Women in Agile over here. So Gillian, in a moment here, is dropping the link into the chat box, which will take you to Mural. And what we're going to do is we're going to run through some of the activities on the Monday and the Tuesday. So mapping and sketching it. Let me just turn off the presentation here. And I'm going to go to Mural myself. Perfect. So type in the chat here if you're ready and you're in there, so that we can all get started. I see there's a ram, there's an owl, a fish. You don't have to have an account to get into Mural. There we are. So I think most of us are there now. And so just as a quick reminder, our challenge was to help Zip validate whether an expansion is possible for them. So Gillian, would you like to walk us through the first activity?
Sure. Okay. So if you remember on day one, we're trying to map the challenge. Strategy to include a web event software, we might articulate the long-term goal like this. So the question that I'd ask ourselves is, where do we want to be in 6 months, a year, or even 5 years from now to answer the question of what is the long-term goal? So I thought we might say something like, when you go to a virtual event, it's on Zip.
And so for me, I said in 2 years, we have acquired 10,000 active users into our platform and are positioned to be a household name for a virtual event. And so now we're going to turn to all of you, and we'd like to challenge you to write a long-term goal using the prompt in 2 years. What does the world look like now if we're successful? So what you do, Gillian, is you just basically double click on a post-it and you just start typing. So I'll put 2 minutes on the clock here. You'll hear some music and go. We're so excited to see. Maybe we can even show this to Zip, the meeting conference video platform. Maybe they'll be interested.
Maybe they will.
Yeah. So in a design sprint, long-term goal setting is really about thinking of the big picture, thinking out in the horizon, if everything is successful, if everything didn't go according to plan or went according to plan, this is where my company would be. Some people choose to write metrics into it, like, you know, 10,000 users. Some people want to keep it as big picture as possible.
I don't know about you, but I found this pretty hard to do. So Kim reassured me that there was no wrong answer.
No. Yeah, there's definitely no wrong answer.
And plus, having tons of brilliant people in the room helped surface something that would be helpful for us to move forward with.
Yeah. Do you remember the long-term goal for Newlogy, Gillian?
Yeah. So in 2 years, we wanted the co-man. We wanted something more. It was a little deeper, but we wanted both the planner, and we also wanted their customers, the consumer packaged goods people, to be able to collaborate interactively on their forecasting.
Yeah. So that was great. It was a good anchor for, or a North Star, sorry, not an anchor, but a North Star to the rest of the activities. You've got 9 seconds left. No pressure. If you haven't written anything, it's okay. I'll delete some of these empty post-its. All right, so time's up. I'm just going to read out a couple of them, Gillian, just so we have a reference. So someone said, in 2 years, we will be synonymous with virtual conferencing. Very cool. In 2 years, we would be able to support hybrid virtual and live physical event. That's cool. Ooh. Right? In 2 years, gross over $10,000 in monthly recurring revenue. Amazing. So, you know, you really have to shoot for the big, like the big vision here. And then as you go through Monday, it gets a little bit more narrow because you start talking to more experts. You start learning more about what's the reality in the industry. And then when we interview them, what we really like to do is, I'm just going to get you everybody to follow me here. First of all, sorry, I should ask everybody, how did you find writing a long-term goal? Was it easy? Was it challenging?
For me, it was within 2 minutes. It's hard to think of what you want to accomplish, but I think it was fairly straightforward in terms of, if you're under pressure, if you're looking at what you want to accomplish, that it was fairly straightforward in coming up with an idea for the next 2 years.
Yeah, thanks, Ian. Thank you. Anne-Marie, did you want to say something?
Yeah, it was challenging because we often think in the level of detail, and this is what's trying to get a bigger view of, you know, what might be like. So that's where I found it challenging. I tend to get into the details very specific.
Yeah, well, it really is about finding that balance of detail, but also making yourself as optimistic as possible. It's supposed to energize you for the rest of the week. So when we want to get down into details, we talk to industry experts. And this is something that I found helpful when I started becoming a facilitator, is how to take notes when we're talking to really, really smart people that you have no idea what they're talking about. So you just have to simplify it. And so it's a tool that we like to call How Might We? But in this instance, Gillian.
We are all subject matter experts on using video conferencing tools and participating in virtual events. So perhaps we might think ourselves about what observations we have about this long-term goal and what might be the issues. I think I have an example here. So one thing I noticed was that it's really tough to have an informal conversation on a modern video conferencing platform. So I wrote a how might we have informal conversations?
Yeah. And for me, it was more of like, it's similar to Gillian. So we heard that it was hard to have like informal conversations. She wrote it as how might we make possible to have informal conversations. I wrote it as how might we enable simultaneous conversations. So two different people wrote two different things, but about the same sort of insight from the expert, right? So why don't we have all of you write an insight? So think about a problem with the current video platform that we're on and maybe convert that into an insight into something that you can action with. So first, maybe it's like, it's hard to mute or unmute ourselves. How might we make a feature that's blah, blah, blah. So I'll give you another 2 minutes here and you can write as many as you'd like.
Thanks for the music, Kim.
No problem. That's another facilitator tip, actually. Just get ready with some playlists for yourself and the members so that while they're ideating, they have soft background music to keep them inspired. So as you're thinking through those insights, make sure that you're also converting them into questions. And the importance of that is actually when you go through a design sprint, these how might we notes become an actionable opportunity for us. So instead of it being a problem, it actually becomes a question that we can have an answer for. So instead of we can't have informal conversations, Gillian is now asking, how might we make it possible to have an informal conversation? We've got some 10 seconds left. And I'd love to hear at the end of this from someone how they thought that went. All right, so time's up. We have some really great ones here. So it's one insight is it's hard to tell how people are engaged. And their question was, how might we do that without being annoying and asking out loud? So how might we help facilitators, presenters, hosts engage or be able to tell the engagement of their audience? I mean, this is such a true problem. Even right now, I know you are all engaged because you're all writing over here, but that's not always the case for a lot of presenters, right, Gillian?
That's true.
Yeah. So how did everyone find that exercise? You can unmute. You can go back into Zoom.
I noticed some people were popping things in the chat too. So that's great as well.
Yeah.
I know that when we did this during the design sprint, we had so many stickies from everyone, especially since we were interviewing a number of experts. And part of the Monday mapping the challenge was just sort of grouping them and picking which ones we really wanted to focus on.
Yeah, thanks for that reminder, Gillian. Actually, why we do the how might we's too as a facilitator is it helps us organize the notes a little bit better so that there's a consistent flow to it. Okay, so this is part of day one. And then we move on from this positive, sort of optimistic, curious mindset. And then we take you now to a little bit more of a pessimistic point of view. Gillian, do you want to talk us through the riskiest assumption in the sprint questions?
Yeah, so the riskiest assumption are things that you think might go wrong. And this gives us more sort of like more content for ideation. So one example is that we noticed that there were, with our video conference platform, we noticed that there are many possible event collaboration platforms out there. So if we were to frame that in terms of like a question, it would be instead of, hey, there's like 1,000 different platforms out there, we could ask, can we create a unique value proposition to help us stand out?
Yeah, so maybe put on your business hat and just think of many ways that our development, that this product can go wrong. And instead of putting in as a statement, start again with, can we? So prompt yourself to ask that question. Can we overcome that obstacle? So I'm going to put in 2 minutes here. And feel free to type in as many as possible. Oh, music, Kim. What are the other things that could go wrong except for competing? I mean, people are just exhausted of virtual events, right? Like, how can we convince them that virtual events are the thing of the future?
Can we make virtual events even better then?
Ooh, I love that. Can we make virtual events even better than physical based events? We just gave them a new one, Jillian. It's really, so this is sort of the roller coaster of a design sprint. First, we ask you to be really optimistic, think big picture, and then we get you to talk to some experts, which gets you sometimes excited and sometimes even more curious. And then we take you through this exercise to say, what if you fail? Like, what happens if you fail? And what would that be like? And what happens with these questions is they not only serve a purpose of keeping us aware, but it also becomes a learning goal. And it's actually a really great tip for Agilists. If you ever want to make a metric or a learning goal, you can do sprint questions. So I see most people have typed up something. Can we overcome less users joining? Yeah. Or can we collaborate in real time virtually and restore and rejuvenate people? I love that. That's so great. Okay, so you've sort of completed day one, most of day one's activities. What comes next after this is we map out the opportunities that you have with the long-term goal, with your target users, and then we end day one on that note, which prepares you for our next activity, which is the four-part sketching. But we're not going to do the entire four-part, Jillian, right?
Right. We're just going to do the crazy eights, or in this case, the crazy fours, or possibly the crazy threes.
Yes, or the crazy threes. Yeah, we can definitely do it in 3 minutes. So what I'm going to ask you to do, that paper and pen that I had asked for you to have, we're going to take this exercise offline. So just because it's a remote design sprint doesn't mean we lose touch of certain things that we do in a real design sprint. And we fold this paper twice so that you have, in this case, we'll only try it three times. So you'll have three panels. Mine's a sticky note. It kind of ripped, but there should be a thing there. I hope, I mean, I can't see anybody, but I'm putting the faith that you guys are actually folding your papers. And I'm going to put 4 minutes, or no, 3 minutes on this clock. And I will ask you to choose a riskiest assumption or a how might we, and ideate on that one idea and sketch out how you might solve for that idea. Either one idea in four different ways, or three ideas in 3 minutes. Sounds good? I hope. All right, I'm gonna put 3 minutes here and I'm gonna start the timer. So think about how you might solve for this, whether it's probably, can we create a unique value proposition? No one's gonna see your drawing. Just draw out as much as you can. You have a minute per square.
When do we start, Kim?
Oh, sorry. We can get started now. Let me put up the timer here again. And the music.
Cool. So everyone has picked a how might we, or a riskiest assumption, and is sketching one of their ideas, right?
Yes, exactly. One or three ideas that they want, but one per minute. So your first box, you have 20 seconds left. And you should be getting ready to move on to your second box right now. How far can you take this idea? How far can you take that sketch a little bit more? Can you add more details to it, less? Can you remove some details out of it to help solve for that problem that you've chosen? You should be in your second box. Yep, and then so in just a minute here, you should be, or in just a few seconds here, you should be on your third box. And then we'll be wrapping up our session. All right, so you should be moving on to your next box. How different can you make this solution? How much more detail can you add? How much less detail can you add? Is it missing a word maybe? What color are you thinking of? Just put that down on paper. Did you look at it another way, maybe? So you have 30 seconds. All right, the last 10 seconds is here. I'm gonna stop the music. I'm gonna ask everyone to come back into Zoom. And we're just gonna go through what happens at the end of a sprint. So congratulations, everybody. You've just sort of went through some parts of the sprint, but those 5 days can feel really intense. But you always just have to keep in mind that at the end of a sprint, here are some of the outcomes that you can expect. At the end of a sprint, you have decided on a problem to tackle, which is much more than what a lot of people can say. You've also had a collection of solutions to the challenge. You've picked one and you built a low fidelity prototype for it, and you validated the solution with some real users. And I know we only have 3 minutes left. Maybe there's one question that we can answer from the group here, if you have any questions. All right, I think there are no questions. I just want to thank Gillian for having me as her co-facilitator. I also want to thank Rebecca and Sheila for putting together such an awesome event. I got to meet a lot of you guys in this intimate sort of session that we had.
I really appreciate you all coming out. It's so much fun to share an experience like this with you. And I hope you'll also this as part of something you might have in your toolbox.
Yeah, and if you ever have any questions, you can reach Gillian and I on LinkedIn. We've got our names up there and also our emails if you ever have any questions that you want answered that we didn't answer today. And I hope you enjoyed the session.
This was great. Thank you so much. I learned a lot.
Thanks Rebecca, for organizing.
Well, yeah. Thank you all for coming.